It was definitely not in my mind that I was writing a book. Sorting things out in language, whether you think of yourself as a writer or not, is one way to feel like you have a better grip on your world, especially when it feels like your world is completely out of control. I started out as a poet, and then I wrote for national magazines. Then I took an editing job right when my mother moved into the house across the street from me because she couldn't live safely alone anymore. Shortly after my mother died, very suddenly, my mother-in-law entered hospice care. And so I felt completely subsumed by grief and mortality. And so it was like the grounding of my life had shifted. And a friend of mine said to me, "Would you ever want to write about that?" And it reminded me that writing was the way I made sense of the world. And for 5 years, I had just given it up. And so I started giving myself 15 minutes a day, first thing in the morning, to just write a little bit about my grieving and my love for my mother and also for my mother-in-law. And gradually those little pieces piled up. And at the same time, I was spending a lot of time looking out the window. The natural world was a real source of solace for me because I spent so much of my childhood outdoors. So eventually I started writing about the birds and the butterflies and the snakes in my yard, my little bitty half-acre lot in suburban Nashville. And those two little piles of essays, very short, the kind of thing you can write in 15-minute periods of time, I realized they were talking to each other. And then I started thinking about it as a book without really any clear understanding of how that might work. Milkweed Editions, this wonderful nonprofit press, had an open reading period for creative nonfiction. And I submitted a sample just to try. The editor there, Joey McGarvey, who's just a brilliant editor, she and I had several conversations over the phone, and it was her idea to put the family essays in a sequence, in a narrative arc, chronological, and then take the nature essays and intersperse them as they picked up a theme or picked up an image or picked up a recurrent motif of some kind. And that was the organizational principle that helped me figure out how to structure the book. The nature essays and the family essays didn't need to be separate things if I was remembering a life spent largely in nature. I spent my early childhood in Lower Alabama, spent my school years in Homewood outside Birmingham, and then I went to college in Auburn. And in all the time that I was living in those places, I was spending vast swatches of time at my grandparents' farm in the deep rural country, one church, one little store, and that was it. This landscape is so thoroughly imprinted on me that I still, after 32 years, think of myself as a visiting Tennessean. A blue jay calls, and to me, I'm right back in Lower Alabama. Blue jays have a sound that sounds almost exactly like a squeaky screen door, like when the hinge is squeaking. And I hear that, and I'm home. The earliest memory I have is of our little house in Andalusia. It must have been a vacant lot between our house and the closest house, because it didn't have any trees in it, but there was also no house there. And I have this very, very clear memory of walking through grass that was as tall as my head and holding onto the stroller that my brother was sitting in as our mother pushed us up the hill through that vacant lot to the next door neighbor's house. So the blue jays see a hawk. That's what that sound is. But anyway, so that, it's not what you think of as nature. It's what you think of as, I guess, almost like the Brady Bunch. But there were rattlesnakes in that grass. There were grasshoppers. There were butterflies. So I think that was as much a part of my understanding of nature as my grandparents' farm. My brother, Billy Renkl, who is a collage artist, is only a year younger than I am. And his artwork is very aesthetically similar to my aesthetic as a writer. He's very interested in birds and flowers, and this was the story of our family. It was the story of grief over our parents. As we went through the editing process, Billy was going to do the cover illustration. Then they said, what if Billy made some work specifically for this book? He had this great idea, I think really brilliant idea, that he would not attempt to illustrate the family essays because that almost limits how someone would read it. People reading it, we hope, will see their own family, their own grandmother, their own rural background if they have it. So he focused on the nature essays, but he ordered 40 or 50 little picture frames from antique photo albums. He worked the collages around those frames, and that visually, I think, helps tie the two threads of the essays together in a way that I hadn't even anticipated. Paying attention, a little closer attention, to the natural world of my backyard. It's not like this. It's not a wilderness. There's nothing about it that would probably strike you as a wildlife sanctuary, although I've worked very hard to make it wildlife friendly. But the more attention I paid, the more I realized that we aren't separate from the natural world in the way that we like to imagine. When I was growing up in Lower Alabama, we did not have air conditioning. I did not know anyone who had air conditioning. The windows were open probably 10 months out of the year. And so the natural world and the human world were very intertwined, or at least the membrane between the two was much more permeable than we think of today. Because if it was gonna rain, you smelled it. If the wind was blowing, you felt it. If the birds were singing, you heard it. Everything was much more in concert. But we have sealed off our homes, and even some people just drive straight into their garages. They never even step out into their yards. If you can't understand that you are a natural creature, then you won't understand that what happens to the natural world is what's going to happen also to you. It doesn't change anything, the fact that we have imagined ourselves to be sequestered from this world. We are part of it. And that, you know, one of the key things we share is mortality. So in a way, the natural cycles of life and death made me feel less singled out for suffering, and that this grief was just part of a much bigger cycle of life and death that makes sense. It's painful, but it makes sense. So I think of the book as a love letter to my family, but also a love letter to the natural world and the way human cycles of life and death intersect with natural cycles of life and death.